to see you all out this morning, and we are moving into this fall season. Hallelujah. It's feeling good to put a jacket on and being out. And I was telling my wife that, you know, when it's 50-something degrees and it feels a little cool, when we get to spring, all of a sudden it's going to feel like a heat wave, right? I mean, it's like, it's all getting used to it. So we're getting used to the cold as it gets a little bit colder, and thank God that it doesn't happen all at once. We are very thankful for that. But we are thankful that there is heat in the building when you come in, and it's a nice warm place to be. Warm in the physical sense, but also warm in the spiritual sense. That God is here and is present. For where there are two or three of you gathered in His name, He is among you. So praise God. Those of you who are at home watching or watching it later on, I encourage you to have some people around you. If you have a little group of people that is your little bubble, make sure you watch together, have service together, because we do the whole service. And you know, it's good to follow through. Praise God. We just have a moment of prayer to call of worship. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all the things. We pray that the technology would work correctly, Lord God, that you would have your hand upon it. Lord God, that we would be able to be opened and receiving to all that you have for us this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, as Edna starts to play, you can turn your attention to the Lord, turn off your cell phones, and turn on your attention to God. Amen. And see what He has to say to you today. Amen.
Also give a money offering too for them. They gladly accept that too, so that they can purchase food for people that are hungry. So God bless you. Do your part. We would really appreciate that. Then we have prayer meeting on Monday night. We've had a couple of new people come and join us now, which is wonderful. And we're having a great time.
What do you mean by come?
Huh?
I mean they came.
Oh, well, they came in by conference call. It's a very safe way to pray, you know, on the phone. So praise the Lord. You don't have to even go from the comfort of your home. You can sit on your bed, you can sit on your couch in your recliner, and just have your phone on. And it's a good thing. So we have an enjoyable time. One of our friends hasn't been able to join us for a couple weeks, but she'll be back tomorrow night, so we're thankful for that. Patty Mariano, as you know from Parkway a long time ago, she's working at the Walter Hoving Home. She tunes in with us when she can, but many times she can't because she's busy, because she got a job up there. And, you know, she used to travel all over the world, and that's been come to a slamming halt, as you well know. So they offered her a job, and she's going to be working there for at least another year, which is wonderful that God made a way for her to have something to do. You know, what a wonderful ministry. If you don't know about Walter Hoving Home, it really takes women from the streets, from difficult situations, from dysfunctional families, from addictions, from all kinds of walks of life, and literally rescues them, lets them stay there. It's a very Christ-centered operation, and it's a wonderful thing what they're doing, and they're really helping these ladies that have had a really tough time with it. So praise God. Then we have our church service at 10 o'clock next week. If you have any prayer needs, please let us know, not just today, but during the week. Just, you know, I get people that sometimes message me on my phone or message me on Messenger. Those are all good things to do. Whatever you want to do, any time of day or night, we are available to pray, and we will pray, because that's what God wants us to do. And we've seen such wonderful answers to prayer. It's just been awesome. So I thank God that He's on the throne, and He's in charge, and in the midst of all of the craziness of our nation, and the riots, and the disruptions, and the political opinions, we thank God that He is on the throne. He's in charge. So we are happy for him. God bless you all.
Amen. And in way of announcements also, I told you that we should be praying. It's kind of a double-edged thing, is that Peggy Park's grandson, Brandon Ventrella, passed away finally. He passed on Thursday. And the funeral is on Monday. So keep the family in prayer as they go through this loss. So, amen. He was a young man, and little family sorely misses him already. Amen. So keep him in prayer. That'll be at 11 o'clock on Monday. Amen. Well, we take a look at your song sheet. Number 94, pardon me. I'd rather have Jesus. Let's stand together. Amen. You may be seated. Those of you who are at home and are already seated, you can stay seated. Hallelujah. Praise God. I just want to take any testimonies. Does anybody have a testimony? Yes.
So, a lot of you know I work at FedEx Ground, and I was working for a company, a contractor that kind of sold everything. Anyways, towards the end of that, I was getting really angry and annoyed with everyone, and it was affecting my relationship with my managers and some of the staff there. Finally, I just couldn't take it anymore. I walked away. I contacted my manager, apologized, and he understood where I was coming from, and he actually gave me a contact to another contractor there that would, I guess, suit me better. Anyways, I went from Southbury, now I work in Oxford, and things are, I feel much better. I have the right vehicle, I have the right situation. It just happened to be yesterday, on the weekends you don't do ground, you just do home delivery. So they stuck me in Shelton, which is a dream for anybody at FedEx, because you're close by, everything's close, you can potentially make serious money. Anyway, towards the end, I gave him a call and I said, you know, if this route ever opens up, please let me know. And I'll know tomorrow whether or not that route opens up.
Amen.
But the point is Sunday, I prayed because Monday was going to be my first day on my own in Oxford, and it can be a bit tough. And all week long, let me tell you, he's looked out for me.
He's been there.
I've had people help me. They've taken. Amen. They've distributed the route properly. I still made enough, and I learned my route. By the end of the week, I learned my route. So I know that the company I'm with is where he wants me to be at the moment.
Amen.
And the situation all worked out. So I want to thank God, the management for my company, and just the people around.
Amen.
Now, I know I'm rushing here, but I'm also going to go into prayer across my shoulder and neck. And I don't know if it's what it is, but just some of the pain in there.
Amen.
That's it for me.
Amen. Praying for you for your healing. Amen. Tough to work without the without being able to use that shoulder. Exactly. Amen. Yes, Marge.
Well, I praise the Lord that somebody invented hearing aids.
Hearing aids. Hallelujah.
Battery has to be replaced sometime. So yesterday I'm replacing the battery and it hit me. If somebody didn't have the smarts to do this, you wouldn't be here. So I don't want to take it for granted.
Amen. Thank God for hearing aids. Hallelujah. My wife tells me that I need it sometimes. Hallelujah. One that works and one that's not working. But praise God. Hallelujah. God is good. Anybody else? Yes, Butch.
As I mentioned last week, my granddaughter was home, but then she went back on Thursday, and me and my daughter brought her back on Thursday, which wasn't actually in my plans for a week. Well, we took her back to school, and we just prayed that the Lord would give her safe jobs, and she did, even though we had a little detour because the exit was cold. So they kicked her off Philly a little bit, and I don't know if anybody had to go to Philadelphia. A lot of one-way streets, and they walked on both sides of the road, so it was very narrow, and the streets aren't exactly level, but some of them actually are not at an angle. Those part of the street is giving away. So anyway, the Lord guided us through that, and coming home, you know, it was a little longer because of the fact that the bridge there, you know, we don't say this is an example for that. But, you know, I wanted to show you how to do. What I was talking about with the prayer group on Monday night, because me and Barb, one of the people on the prayer group there, and it's not only just a prayer, you know, that I have an opportunity to pray, but, you know, Mondays sometimes are pretty hectic days for myself at work or something, a few hours or so, and you know, just moving forward to get away from all of that. And when we go with the prayer, it's a whole different thing, not only for ourselves, but we may want to bring up before the Lord. Just because of the other people there, and they give some testimonies that things we know we've been praying about, and we hear about the healing, we hear about things that have happened. getting jobs and where
Amen.
The may be. There's so many different things that come up that just turns your whole day around. I mean, it really makes a big difference in that one fact, but just that little bit of time that we dedicate to prayer and support.
When we can share testimonies of people getting jobs and getting the right job, amen. Still praying for some people to get a job. Hallelujah. We keep it in prayer and healings, you know. Amen. We have people that have COVID, we know of, and praying for them and praying for those who are, you know, in situations where they just need to be careful. So pray God will give us wisdom in those situations and through that all. But we are very thankful. We're very thankful that in our little family here that people have not gotten it. Some people did have it, but they're through it. Hallelujah. And hopefully not to return again. Right, Chris? You know, don't want it back. And you too, right?
Yes.
Amen. Jose was just saying today that he had it and it's gone, but you know, now they talk about you might be able to get it again and this and that. Come against that. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Stay healthy. Anybody else have a testimony? Prayer request? We still have?
Yeah, Ellen and Richard.
Okay. Amen.
What's prayer request?
I couldn't hear you.
A prayer request?
No.
You should repeat what you said.
Okay. The two names you said were?
Ellen and Richard.
Ellen and Richard. Okay. Yes.
I have a prayer request.
Yep.
One of my childhood friend's mother got very sick into the hospital.
Okay. And childhood friend's mom's in the hospital.
Yep. Her mom.
Yep.
In the hospital. And then I just found out that she seems to be getting a little better. But I want to keep continuing prayers.
Amen.
For her and her family. And also some prayers for me because my legs and back have been acting up.
Pray those legs in that back situation. Amen. Amen. We have the two young kids who have been battling cancer. We need to continue to keep them in prayer. And the financial burden to the families is not easy. So pray that the Lord will help those families to get through the storm of taking care of their kids and battling those cancers. Amen. Any other prayer concerns today, besides overall the world's condition and the United States' condition and all the craziness that's going on all over the place and general problems? We continue to pray for those things. But we truly believe that there's going to be a revival in the land, and it comes from the church first. So the church, you know, we who are believers, you know, need to continue to take a stand and see what God's going to do. Amen. There was a football coach just recently who got fired because he was very, very bold. He had a sign that somebody stuck on his office door that said Black Lives Matters, and he took that off, and he put up a sign that says All Lives Matters to Jesus Christ our Lord. I mean, that's pretty bold. I mean, to say All Lives Matters is one thing, but he added to the end of the sign, In Jesus Christ our Lord. I mean, that was like so bold. Now, if somebody said something about Jesus Christ and sharing your faith, and somebody said, well, I really don't like the fact that you're sharing your faith, that's one thing. But they called it hate speech. And I'm sitting there going, excuse me? Oh, yeah, because you took that down and you put that other one up. That's hate speech. And I'm sitting there going, wow. If Christians are going to be called haters because we believe in Jesus Christ our Lord, if we believe about the soon return of Jesus, if we are preaching that he can forgive us of our sins, that he is the way, the truth, and the light, if we're preaching Jesus and they call that hate, it just goes to show what the Bible says, that in the end times, they're going to call light dark and dark light, right wrong and wrong right. It's just showing it's a part of the times. But I'm just here to encourage you that in spite of it all, he's still on the throne. His name is above every name. And at the very end, we know that every knee, doesn't say some of the knees, it says every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So, you know, if we're going to bend a knee, we need to bend a knee to Him, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior. So, encourage you that you will turn to Him, that you will take that time that we know that we are never, never forsaken, no matter what happens in our situations. Health, wealth, jobs, spiritually, emotionally, ups, downs, He is with us all the time. I just want you to know that He is with you all the time. He's as close as the mention of His name. Amen? And when you mention His name, you know, do it as a prayer. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord God, there are so many things. There are people who are so affected by diseases and maladies and injuries. Lord God, we've had three prayer requests right here in our midst, Lord, that need a touch from You. And we know that, Lord God, You are the great physician. You are the healer. You are the deliverer. And Lord God, we pray right now that it would be a testimony to these individuals and to us present, Lord God, that You touch and You heal them, Lord God. Not in us and not in what we do, but what You do. In the name of Jesus, we thank You, Lord God, that You are there and that You stick closer than a brother, Lord God. And those who are in difficult situations, especially when little children are so sick, Lord God, we come and we pray for them, Lord God. And we ask You to touch them, heal them, encourage their parents and those around them, Lord God. Give them the financial need that they have being met, Lord God. For You are God who hears and answers prayer, Lord God. Lord, be with them, Lord God, that You would receive the honor and the glory and the praise both now and forever. Lord Jesus, we thank You for Your nearness to us. And Lord God, through all the things that are going on in the world, and all the hatred, Lord God, and that is directed against Your church, Your people, Lord God, help us not to respond with anger, Lord God, but Lord, that we would continue to be just like You were. When You were on the cross, that You said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So, Lord God, we know that You've called us to love one another as You have loved us. In that difficult situation, I pray for each person that is a hearer of this prayer, Lord, that they would continue to pray that to be more like You, Lord God. And that we would pray for those who despitefully use us. That we would pray for those people who are considered our enemies. That we would pray for all of those who are in need, Lord God. And that we would have a giving heart just like You do, Lord God. And that You would use us, Lord God, for Your kingdom's sake. Lord, continue to speak to us. Let the Holy Spirit give us the words to say when we are out and about in this world, Lord God, that we would not speak on our own authority, but on the authority of God. Lord, we thank You that You have promised us to give us the wisdom that we need, and that if we would lack, we should ask for that wisdom. We thank You and praise You in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You know, God is so good. You know, we just need to continue to trust Him the more. I sometimes get excited about things, you know. And we need to see that God has that in our spirit, that it's a good thing to get excited about God. And see what the Lord has done, you know. And we just happened to watch a little silly movie last night. It was called Shouting, or A Man Named John. It was called Man Named John. Interesting thing, and this guy just felt the Spirit of God was upon him, and when he did, he'd start like dancing, and he'd start dancing, and he'd start running around the church. And he was the pastor of the church. And the pastor felt that was the way God had moved in his heart. But the congregation didn't think that that was the right thing, and they voted him out. They voted him out. And they sent him out, and the bishop placed him in a church. And the interesting thing about it, this guy was white. and the bishop put him in a black church. And when he reported to serve at the church, they were, are you in the right place? And this is where they sent me. And they received him, and they saw what God was doing. He fell in love with the congregation. After he had fallen in love with the congregation, he got a letter from the bishop saying, oh, we sent you to the wrong church. After they had accepted him, after they had seen something in him, something that was received by him, something that brought life to the church, they said, we made a mistake. And they sent him to this dry old church, and he walked in, and he's like, Lord, you really? I had a hard time, but I felt like you put me in the right place. But now, well, I'll go where you want me to go. You know that hymn. You know that hymn. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord. You know, Lord, you won't send me here? And finally, it turns around, and in the end, I know I'm spoiling the story for you if you want to watch the movie, but he gets called back to that other church, and God uses him in a mighty way to bring a growth and a coming together in that church. That church was no longer just a, quote, black church. It was something that was wider and bigger and more important than all of that. And I said, wow, what a movie for today, you know? Are we where God wants us to be? Do we do what God wants us to do? That's the big question. And that's part of my message today, is are we the church? Are we the believers in Jesus Christ doing what God wants us to do? Amen? Let's take a moment for prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord God, I pray for an anointing for me to bring forth the words that you want me to bring forth. But Lord God, I pray for an anointing to all the hearers of this word, that your Spirit would be upon them and that they would receive exactly what they have need of. Lord God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you work with the impossible, Lord God. For nothing is impossible with you, Lord God. The scriptures tell us that all things are possible to them who believe. And Lord God, we believe. And Lord, now help our unbelief. Lord God, touch our hearts this day in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'd open up your Bibles with me to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. Now, the book of James is a great book, and James has a particular way of calling us out. And we need to know that when we get called out on certain things, it's okay to say, ouch, hello. When God speaks to us and says that you didn't have it exactly right, there's no problem with us saying, yes, Lord, and making some changes in our lives. Well, in James chapter 4, okay, I'm not going to do the whole chapter. I'm only going to do the first 8 verses. And in, I don't know what it says in your Bible, but I have little headings at the top of each chapter. And for this one, it says, things to avoid. Things to avoid. Now I'm going to read the 8 verses, and then I'm going to come back and I'm going to preach on those 8 verses. You know, I'll just tell you this, that my dad was taught by an old preacher. And the old preacher taught him, he says, now look, when you do put your sermon together, you got to tell the people what you're going to tell them. Then you got to tell them. He says, and then you got to tell them what you told them. And he says, and if they don't have it by then, you have to leave it in God's hands. So I'm going to try to do that. I'll try to stay with that. Amen. So if you're all with me in James chapter 4, it says this. What is the source of quarrels and conflicts among you? Is not the source of your pleasures that wage war against your members? You lust and do not have. so you commit murder. And for the envious, you cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. Do you not have because you do not ask? And you ask and do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, so that you may spend it on your pleasures. You adulteress, do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility toward God? Therefore, wish a friend of the world makes himself an enemy to God. Or do you think that the scripture does not speak this purpose? He jealously desires the spirit that he has made to dwell in you. But he gives a greater grace. Therefore, it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he shall flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, O sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. Just those eight verses, I want to break it down into six things that we need to avoid. Now, I've heard this preached before in one way, and they talk about worldwide problems and all these conflicts and blah, blah, blah. But it really, as I started to look at it and study it and do even some commentary on it, it breaks it down very, very clearly in this way. What is the sources of the quarrels and the conflicts among you? So you have to break down, who is the you that James is speaking to? It's not me, it's them. No, the Bible doesn't say them. It says you. And the you that he's speaking to is not the people in the world. Because then it would say them. What's the source of conflicts with them? No. He's speaking to the church here. And even within that, we know that in history past, okay, the conquests of certain worlds and things that were pressed through and certain denominations would rule and reign, and there are some that would say, well, just do as we say, not as we do, and you don't have the right to read the Bible. Really? You know, when the Bible first came in print, it was wonderful. Wow! Now the Bible can be out there for common man. But there was one problem. Most of the world was illiterate. If I gave you a book in Chinese, said, here, read this, it's going to help you. Huh? I don't understand that. But when we have the Word of God, and it's printed in our own language, and it's laid out before us, when we have people that have it, and have you memorize certain scriptures, and hold on to it, and be able to take the little glimpse of what God has placed in your heart to remember, we need to be called upon it. Going back. So what's the source of the quarrels and conflicts that you have? And it goes on to say, is not the source your pleasures that rage war in your members? You know, I've been on a diet for the last few months. Okay? And something that rages within me, that jumps out and attacks me, is cookies, donuts, ice cream. We took my little granddaughter out for lunch just the other day. We had gone to the park and had a good time. We took her down to, what's the name of that place? Overton's, right by the water. And she had a cheeseburger. And she ate all these French fries, or ketchup mostly, but she dipped it and had more ketchup than French fry, but God bless her. So as we are walking back to the car, she looks at me and she says, "Ice cream, please." And the way she said it was not, "Oh, I want ice cream." She says, "Ice cream, please." So I said to my wife, I said, "How can you not break down?" And I said, "This place right here, we get a little dish." She goes, "Well, you're going to feed it to her because she's not going to eat it on her own. What a mess it would be." Well, we're trying to rush through feeding. I said, "Well, why don't you take a couple bites?" Boy, I could have just taken that one little cup and one bite. But I said, "Okay, I'll just take a little bite." And I was thinking about the battle that goes on in the flesh. You know, well, how many calories are in just one little bite? You know, well, it's not the one little bite. It's the lust of the flesh. It what takes over an unhealthy, unholy desire of things. It says right here, things that wage war. You lust. You have unholy desires. Okay? And it can be on anything. It can be sexual, it can be financial, it can be food, it can be all kinds of things, unholy desires. He says, you lust and you don't have, so you commit murder. Whoa, that spoke volumes to me. I don't know about you, but the abortion issue is one that is there. It's an excuse. It's lust and you don't have it, so you commit murder. We need to take a look at the way that our lives are. You are envious of somebody else. Wow, you see that new car he has? Yeah, do you see the payments he has? You know, sometimes we think about one part and not about the other. You know? Making choices in life. But we lust after things. We are envious over things. Okay? And we can't obtain it, so what do? We fight and quarrel. You don't have because you don't ask. Now, let me put it to you, church, something that is very, very important and is still becoming a worldwide problem is the prosperity gospel. It's been in the United States for a long time. It's in other countries and even taken to little bitty places where the people are extremely poor, and then they press this prosperity. Well, if you ask, God's going to give it to you. But give me mine first, right? Mm-hmm. Some pastors, preachers, or whatever you want to call them, are not preaching the whole gospel, the message. They're taking and perverting the truth. The word of God is being twisted. And it's saying to us here, he says, you don't have because you don't ask. And you ask and don't receive because you ask with wrong motives, so that you might consume it upon your flesh. You know, this is the problem. We see that the gospel is true, but it's twisted. It's perverted. It's made to work for certain people, and it's a pyramid scheme that is beyond all measure. We need to know that it's not what God has called for us. It says in Matthew chapter 7, it talks about, ask and it shall be given to you, seek and ye shall find, and knock and the door shall be opened unto you. And then it goes on to talk about how God gives good gifts. It says, would a father give his son a serpent? So much more, God gives good gifts to his children. But then it goes on, and a lot of people don't see that the verse that comes right after that talks about that you are to go and to give as God gives. God gives sacrificially. God gives wholeheartedly. Jesus gave his very life. He gave up his deity in heaven to come down to earth. He came to save us, to become a servant's heart, to give his very life for us, and show us how to give. But people would say, well, ask and it'll be given to you. Seeking, and you're going to get it. Just knocking, and the door gets opened up. Well, I thank God that sometimes he doesn't open the door. You know, there are certain doors that we really shouldn't go through. We go into certain situations, and, you know, we're knocking on this door, and we're upset because the door doesn't open. Well, thank God that you didn't open that door, because I shouldn't have been in that place anyhow. Sometimes it has to do with jobs. The testimony we just had here was he got the job and he was thankful for the job, but it really wasn't a good fit. It was all kinds of problems, and it actually got him angry and all these other. He had to kind of repent that he acted out the way he did, but it wasn't the right fit. Now he feels that it's the right fit, and he's praying for even a better fit. We need to know that God has the right place, the right position, the right purpose for our very existence. And when we learn how to give, it's so much easier to be able to receive. Now, I don't know about you, but I have so many times that I've heard some stories that have to do with what has been given. My son, who came up just last week in a whirlwind trip up for a friend of his at a wedding, and right back down to Virginia so he could go back to work. It was, so did we really see him? I mean, it was like, it was that quick. But one thing that he said to me was, you know, Dad, he says, we need to be able to know how to give. He says, I have a friend that was on the mission field. He says he was down in South America, and he went to this little village, and they honored him as bringing the word of God. Now, it sounds kind of crazy, but he was invited back to this little village, person from the village, to their house for dinner. And he said, oh, okay. And he went back to this little village, and it was just a little hut and a little place and a fire out front with a pot. And he says, well, preacher, he says, you're just going to have to wait a minute. My wife will cook up the dinner real quick. She walked over to the only chicken that was in the yard. One chicken. She reached down and snapped its neck with one little movement. Said, dinner will be ready soon. And he's looking like, what? Now, it wasn't the fact that he had not had fresh chicken. It was not that the way that she did it, but the fact that she did it without even a blink of the eye, for it was the only chicken they had. And they were cooking it up for this guest. And he says, brother, you didn't have to do that for me. He says, you know, I have other things that God provides for me. You didn't have to give it in this way. He says, look, God provides. Tomorrow is another day. I want to increase your faith. He's speaking to the preacher. He's talking to this man who had just preached to the village. He says, I want to increase your faith that God will provide. So what did he do? He was ready to give. We need to know that God has a problem with us not having the proper prayer life. Things to avoid. We need to avoid making things so easy. We need to avoid false doctrine and false teachings. We need to avoid things that make it so easy on us and not going to God. It says, ask. And then that goes on to see our prayer. Why are we praying? What are our motives? It says here that God is not going to answer when our motives are wrong. We need to know that our motives need to be humble and repentant and looking to what God is calling us to do. Remember I told you the other day about preaching? That woman preached a message by reaching down and doing what she did to the chicken. She preached a message about giving, about dependence on God. And not dependence on man. You see, church, we need to learn the lesson that here is in James is talking about. What's our problem? We are not dependent enough upon God. It says avoid having a poor prayer life. Avoid it. When we go to prayer, humble ourselves and go to God. We need to seek His face. It goes on right after that. It's amazing that it lines up two things here. The thing about prayer, the thing about wanting motives and things like that, and it goes right into something that it's talking about, verse 4. Look at it, please. It calls you adulterers. Now, is he talking about women or men? No, he's talking about us as the church, us as being the bride of Christ. Now, guys, we have a problem with us being a bride in that. But what it's saying is a relationship between God and us has to be a union that is here. It says you are an adulterer. We're cheating on God. How are we cheating on God? We are choosing the world over the things of God. It says it right there. Don't you know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? It's hostility towards God. It's turning our back on God. Now, somebody took that and they changed it around in one of the definitions. And instead of saying hostilities, it said like enmity. And I said enmity. And it says, well, enmity is like two magnets. I like this illustration because I'm a science teacher. If you take a magnet and you have the north and the south and they are opposites attract. But if you take two of them and put them on the same, they repel. You push them together and they just pop apart. Okay? Now here's the thing. When we see the fact that the world and God, they both can't be all powerful. They both can't be rulers in your life. And when we try to push them together, what happens? God wants nothing to do with it. If there's sin in our life, He doesn't want anything to do with us. Friendship with the world is hostility towards God, enmity towards God, rejection of God. Now, the rejection of God, so much we see is if we trust completely in government, if we trust completely in having somebody else tell us what to do, if we trust in something else having complete rule and everything that I have is fine. There are people who trust in alcohol and drugs. It doesn't work out too well. If you see what the world has to offer and you see what God has to offer, we know that the church is something that's saying, choose God. Choose God. God is a jealous God. We see this all the way from the very beginning when the Ten Commandments are written. It says, you shall have no other gods before you. It doesn't say, well, you can have some. No. Well, you can choose and just as long as you're there on Sunday. No. It says you shall have no other little g gods before the big G God. We need to know that priorities are straight. We need to know here that God is a jealous God. He wants a relationship with us. Only us. You know, that's why people are so screwed up in the world with what marriage truly means. Between a man and a woman, it's that they will give themselves to each other and them alone. That's it. It's exclusive. And when we have that relationship with God, when we become the bride of Christ, it is an exclusive relationship that God is jealous about anything else. You see, through the Bible, that Lot, the nephew of Abraham, was given a choice. Lot said, look, we can't travel together anymore. If you go right, I'll go left. If you go left, I'll go right. But we need to give ourselves some space here. And Lot looked over and he saw Sodom. And he saw the loveliness of that valley. So it says he set his face towards Sodom. And then when he got close, he said he'd set up his camp outside of Sodom. And then it finally came to the place that he made his resting and he sat in the gatehouse as being a leader in the community of Sodom. But one thing that he didn't do is he didn't come against the ungodliness of that era. He didn't come against the ungodliness of the things around him. He just sat there quietly until God came in and says, there's going to be a judgment that's going to be made, and it pulled him out. And Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed by God because of their ungodliness. The world today, there is a choice to be made. In Romans chapter 12, it says, don't be conformed to the world. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, by the renewing of your spirit. We are not to be conformed to this world. God is saying, I don't want you cheating on me. Don't be conformed to that. Don't let the world tell you how you're supposed to be. I want you as my child. So things to avoid. Avoid cheating on God. Avoid little things that come into our lives that draw us away. Because it's not the sin that's big. It's the sin of the gradual. Little bit. Little bit. Little bit. I know a young man who just recently is having some problems with alcohol. He's not the only one. I know several people. One in particular, he's gone through this problem three times, maybe four. And he says, Pastor, what's wrong with me? I said, hey, the dark side has a lot of problems that make it look enticing. You need to keep your eye and your focus and your trust in God. It's not easy, but God loves us. He loves us so much. It says that he is jealous. Verse 5. Do you not know that the scriptures speak to no purpose? He says he is jealously desires the spirit that he has made to dwell in us. Do you realize that in the beginning, then God took a lump of clay and fashioned it and made Adam? And then he breathed into him life. He breathed into him the spirit. That when we die and we're gone, it says ashes to ashes and dust to dust, the body's gone, but the spirit returns to God. And those of us who love him and are called according to his purpose, it is a wonderful thing. God wants that spirit to return to him, which he put in us. It says he's jealously desires the spirit which he made to dwell in us. Now this is the thing that is wonderful. This is the part, look at your Bible, what it says in chapter 4, verse 6. Chapter 4, verse 6. But he gives greater grace. Therefore it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Woo! That's a great thing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. I was blind, but now I see. You know, we sing the verses, we sing the thing, we look at grace and say, whoa, oh yeah. Grace, grace, God's grace. Greater than all our sins. Oh, finally, woo, grace. But the world, just like I said, the prosperity gospel, which was a fake, there's another gospel that is called the hyper-grace gospel that pushes the fact that, oh, well, God's grace, and you know, once you're forgiven, it's all done. But Paul says, wait a minute. Should I sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Says, grace is wonderful. Grace is in his mercy. Grace is all these other things. But look at the thing that is set up as the why. Factor. God is opposed to what? The proud. You got your own set of things of why you do. You're being conformed to the world. You think that grace is just going to cover it up? He says he's opposed to the proud. So avoid that and turn and be humble. It says, he opposes the proud, but gives grace to who? The humble. Those who confess their faults. I'll be reading a portion of scripture in the Psalms in just a moment here. But we know that God is able. I want you to look at these next couple of verses, and then I'm going to get to the psalm and come back to this this grace and this humble part. In verse 7, it says this: submit therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Some people just think it's a magic incantation. I say God, and he flees. I hold up, see these movies where they hold up a crucifix and the vampire can't come close. They throw holy water at him. And it's not talking about that. It's talking very clearly. Submit, therefore, to God. Submit, therefore, to God. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever had to fill in one of these things online, and you fill in all the information, and you get down to the bottom, and you've done all the things that you've done, and you hit submit, and it doesn't do anything. So you hit the button again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and it doesn't do anything. And then you finally flip back and you find a little red box that you didn't fill in one thing. Oh, okay. And you fill in that little red box and you zoom down to the bottom of the thing and you hit submit. And it doesn't submit. So you kind of almost give up on it and say, well, it must have gone through. It must be, you know, just a little glitch that doesn't tell me. But then a little bit later you flip back and say, there's another spot that you didn't fill in. You didn't click the right boxes. And you finally fill in all the boxes and you go down to the end and you hit submit and it goes, your request has been noted. Well, you know, there are things in our lives that we need to submit to God. And he comes to us and says, well, there's certain things that you're in your life that you need to get straightened out first. There are certain things, and I'm not saying that, you know, it's a big hammer over your head, but God wants us to repent. He wants us to turn to him, submit our very being, ourself, and resist the devil, and he will flee. But if we don't resist, if we don't do these things, if we don't find a way that God has called on us, if we feel this, that's the thing, that if we are having a problem, we need to call on God. And if you're having a problem, you better call on somebody else who has a connection with God, and we can pray. That's the wonderful thing we have with our prayer meeting. When we get together, when somebody has a need, we all have a need, and we pray fervently. Do you know that when the church got together after John and Peter were arrested, and they came back, that they prayed? And they didn't say, oh, they're picking on us. They want to close down the church. Oh, God, you know. No, they didn't. They prayed, God, you have answered in the past. God, give us the boldness to stand. Give us the boldness to go out and do the things we need to do. Give us the power to do what we need to do. And you know what happened to that church? The very foundation of the church was shaken, and the people knew that God was moving. They had the confidence to go out and do what God had told them to do. Submit to God. And then we move forward. Last verse. I'll get done. I promise. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. And purify your hearts, you double-minded. God wants us to draw near to him, but he wants to clean us up. He wants to do it. If you'll turn back in your Bible to the Old Testament, Psalm 51. I'm not going to read the whole thing to you. In Psalm 51, it is a prayer of David, and it's a prayer for pardon. He acknowledges his sin. He tells him how great of a sin and how much of a problem it has been. I want you to move up to verse 9. Psalm 51, verse 9. It says, hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. I don't know about you, but in the quietness of the night, when we turn our hearts to God and we see the sin that's in our lives, the things that we've done or haven't done, and the problems we have with God, do we really say to God, hey, hide your face. Don't look at me. Don't look at the things that I've done. Turn your face away from the things that are sinful in my life. And please, God, blot out. I mean, soak up and take away. Blot out all my iniquities. Now, these are the verses I want you to hold on to, and I want you to memorize and go with you. It says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from thy presence, and do not take thy Holy Spirit from me. Those two verses I want you to take and I want you to go with. Are we ready for God to do a little heart surgery? Are we ready to go and draw so close to God that we can allow him to clean up the problems we have? Create in me a clean heart. Take out all the stuff that needs to be taken out, God. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. We need the Spirit of God, not just sometime. We need the Spirit of God all of the time. We need to know that he has a purpose and a plan. Renew a steadfast spirit within me, and do not cast me away from thy presence. We want to be in the presence of God. Steadfast. It says there, do not cast me away from thy presence, and do not take thy Holy Spirit from me. Let's close in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, Lord God, as we bow our heads and our hearts to you, Lord God, we ask you to do some surgery in our lives, Lord God. The things that we need to avoid, the things that we need to draw close to, we need to draw close to you, Lord God. Create in us a clean heart. Create in us that clean heart. And renew that steadfast spirit. The one that stays. The one that is there all the time. And if we do that, we know that you will not cast us away from thy presence. That we will walk in the light as you yourself is in the light. And that we will have fellowship one with another. Lord, if we have that spirit, we will walk with you, talk with you, and know that you are our own and you are the only way. And we know that your Holy Spirit will be with us. We thank you and we praise you, Lord God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's join in a closing hymn. Draw me nearer. Stand together. I am thine, O Lord. thy power of grace divine. Let my soul look up to a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. When I kneel in prayer and thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, I read the last scripture that we read today. It says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lord God, help us to present ourselves clean because of the shed blood of Jesus. Wash away our sins. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, how precious is the blood that makes us white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your message. We thank you for your spirit upon us, Lord God. Help us to receive all that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.